So here I am on a Monday afternoon at the L20 Hotel School in Liverpool, brand new hotel school, which is committed to delivering relevant industry standards. And with me today is one of the city's top chefs, and if I don't mind me saying so, an old mate, Dave Critchley of the Carriage Works. How are you, mate?
Very good, Gordon.
Good to see you.
And you.
So, whilst this is a visionarydining.com video, and obviously visionary dining covers the nation as we do in all different things, we've decided to focus on Liverpool in 2014 for several reasons. One is that I was born and raised in Liverpool, and it's very close to my heart.
Yep.
Second reason is we did some market research that showed that Liverpool, out of the top 20 cities in the UK, came 19th in terms of food quality per capita. And the third reason is that we want to really engage with an area of the UK that hasn't really lit up yet in terms of food agenda. So if I ask you, Dave, just like to kick off, what's it like to hear that of 20 cities, Liverpool comes 19th?
Well, it's obviously very disappointing to hear that, although it's no surprise to me. After 15 years of being in the city, I've ate everywhere there is to eat in the city. And although there is progression going on, definitely over the last kind of 5-10 years, it is slower compared to possibly other cities around and about. So yeah, it is rather disappointing. Certainly not nice to be in the bottom half, let alone practically touching the bottom. So
who sets the agenda in Liverpool? Is it the public? Is it the market?
I really think, yeah, to a degree, yes.
Right.
Liverpool people know what they like and they know what they want.
So, are you saying that the market is dictating the product and the price?
To a certain degree. I mean, you'll also find that your bigger companies who have come into Liverpool, there's a lot of chains that have come into the likes of Liverpool One, big chains that are knocking out the same food that they do right away across the country. There's no focus on the
controlled menu,
Liverpool cuisine, or it is literally that's the brand standard for the whole country, and they're quite popular, which is unfortunate because the smaller independent restaurants and the stuff doing a lot of local food and the really good food in my eyes possibly don't get the customers or the recognition they deserve in the city. So I think that's one of the issues there.
How would you, in your view, describe, although you work in the best restaurant in Liverpool, sort of generally, how would you describe the provision of skills amongst the 760 restaurants on Merseyside?
I'd say you've probably got a thin spreading of really good chefs scattered throughout those 700 restaurants, to be honest. I think a lot of the good chefs move away from Liverpool for better salaries or better opportunities.
Marcus Waring, Aidan Byrne.
There we go, yeah, do you know what I mean? There's two top examples.
Legends.
Exactly, yeah. And then I think if you're lucky, you're really lucky, and I currently feel very lucky to have the team I do at the moment, because they're young, but they're very good and very passionate. And I think it's a rarity in the city to find a group of lads that I've got there. I've been very fortunate with my team, but throughout the city, I think you struggle to find strong teams that definitely stay together for a while, so I think that's very important as well. You get two or three good members that stay together for a couple of years, then you can build on that.
Yeah.
Over the years, I've always found it hard to keep members of staff in the team because their heads will be turned by a better salary, or as I said, they'll move out of the city for a better opportunity.
Yeah.
So I think that's it, really. I think there is talent there, definitely.
So when you look at Manchester or Newcastle or, say, Edinburgh, where similar demographs, those cities have actually said to the customers, why don't you try this?
Yep.
Why don't you look at that? We won't charge you any more for it,
yeah.
But we'll make more money because we've got more skills that allows us to actually produce that dish at a lower cost, rather than buying in
the more expensive product,
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is there an opportunity for Liverpool to do that?
I think definitely, I think that's a good idea. It's a great theory behind behind cooking, really, isn't it? If you can lower the costs at the restaurant side, the customer can also benefit from that as well. I think there's definitely room for that.
You're here today because you and your chefs have come to one of our training days, the L20 Hotel School, and we've been here with Mary Ellen McTague this morning, and we've looked at, say for example, how sous vide can give you an extra 10% yield on your meat, how very inexpensive ingredients when blended together in certain combinations can create a real wow factor.
Yes.
Now I know that's the way you guys cook anyway. Do you think Liverpool are ready for that?
I think so, yeah. I do think Liverpool as a people, although I said they do know what they like, they're also willing to try new things, and I've put stuff on menus before now which I wasn't so sure whether people would take to it, and they really enjoyed it, so I definitely think there's space here for that kind of the technology basically in cooking.
Yeah.
I think Liverpool people are more than ready for it. I think there's some as good as palates as anywhere else in the country.
You're right.
Yeah. Possibly better.
You know, we kind of like tossed around some figures and we worked loosely, very, you know, these are anecdotal figures, but if you had 700 restaurants that because they were creating something wow that drove more custom, and a combination of that and reducing their costs because they've got the skills, if they could generate an extra £100 a day each, that would add millions into the restaurant industry.
That's brilliant.
That can put more chefs through training, attract more customers, and allow Liverpool to begin to compete, you know, with the rest of the cities.
Keep it, help it maintain the good talent that is here.
Without
it dispersing off to the surrounding areas.
That'd
be good.
Well, Dave, it's been great to catch up with you.
Yeah.
Next time we talk to each other, I'd like to talk to you about your projects.
Yes.
In Liverpool, and your, in fact, hey, I don't think we're going to wait. Why don't you tell us about them?
So being part of a team called Project Scouse, we set up 2 to 3 years ago, based around an idea that wherever you are in the world, you're always going to bump into a Scouser, or at the same time, wherever you are in the world, you should celebrate the fact that you are a Scouser. And the idea kind of centered around one day a year where Scousers, or people from the region anyway, could celebrate Liverpool food and drink wherever they were in the world by making themselves a bowl of Scouse. That was how the idea started there. We then progressed that idea because I didn't want Liverpool to kind of be penned down to this one dish of just Scouse. So the team, which is myself, another chef, another two chefs and a baker, I've done some research into Liverpool's past, food and drink history, all the stuff that's being traded through the ports as well, when Liverpool was a huge port it was. And we've basically set about developing a whole new range of Liverpool dishes, basically, which celebrate all parts of Liverpool heritage and history, and kind of come away from the idea that Liverpool is just Scouse, and that is it, as a dish. We've also looked at local suppliers, local ingredients, so all the ingredients we used in our dishes when we were developing them were sourced within about 10 miles of the Liver building was our centre point, which meant that we could actually pop over to the world because we've got fantastic stuff over there.
Absolutely.
So I mean that's the general idea there. From there we've got several smaller projects which go on. Every February 28th is the day that we've decided is a Global Scouse Day. So there'll be stuff happening this year. We got onto the radio last year and got various restaurants to put their own version of Scouse on the menu, because it was important to us that it was their own interpretation of what it meant to them. So we had Spanish themed restaurants with their Spanish version on there, and South American versions, Asian versions. It was quite fun, yeah.
Because that reflects the amazing multicultural.
Well, that's it, yeah. It's exactly that. Liverpool
mosaic of society in Liverpool.
It's a stock pot almost, isn't it?
It is, isn't it? It is.
So many
simmering gently.
Yeah.
But you know, You make me feel so proud about Liverpool.
Yeah.
And guys, you know what? You know, if you're listening, you're probably thinking, where's Gordon Cartwright's Liverpool accent gone? Well, unfortunately, I have been travelling for 30 years, or 20 years, or 25 years, and it has gone from time to time. But right now, I feel like banging my fists on this table and saying, hey, we are Scousers, and we can cook.
Definitely
so let's show the rest of the country what we can do.
Yeah, and that's what we're all about at the moment. So
yeah,
let's hope we can accomplish that in the next foreseeable future anyway.
Indeed. It's been a pleasure talking to
Thanks
you, mate.
Very much, Gordon.
And we'll catch up again soon.
Definitely.
Take care. Cheers.